This is a video on how to prepare yourself for hoovering. If you are in a relationship or recently got out of a relationship with a narcissist, it is very, very common that they hoover. Hoovering is a manipulation technique. It's named after the Hoover vacuum because it's designed to suck the victims back into the relationship. Hoovering happens generally within the first year of the ending of a narcissistic relationship. Probably most common within like that first month or so, but it can happen decades after your relationship ended. And so, okay, so why does a narcissist hoover? They hoover because narcissists don't view people as people, okay? They view us as sources of supply. Supply that somehow feeds their ego or helps them get something that they feel that they're entitled to, that they should just get for free. So it's some form of food, clothing, sex, shelter, money, social status, public image, those kinds of things. So if they're feeling low in any of those areas, that's when they start targeting different victims. So they'll target different victims for different reasons. You've probably seen this, why it doesn't really make sense. Like, why is he with her? Or why is he back with his ex? Or whatever. It's just whatever's convenient for them. So maybe his ex provides a house for him, or is giving him money, or is paying off debt, or, you know, whatever. So that's why they hoover. If you're not being hoovered, I encountered this too. It sounds so crazy to say, but with Jack, I was almost kind of bummed out that he wasn't hoovering me, because it was almost like that added clarification that I really didn't matter. And that was so incredibly painful. I was in like this sick way. I was hoping that he would hoover me, because at least it would show that he did, in a weird roundabout way, show that he cared. But really, they don't care. Hoovering is not a sign that they care at all. It's a sign that they are coming back to use you. So if they're not hoovering you, it's basically that they're not identifying you as a potential supply source at that time. But it's very important that you prepare yourself for it, because this is what it gets victims sucked back into these relationships. And on average, victims leave a crazy relationship like this 7 times before they either leave for good or they're killed. So very important that you realize that these relationships, they do tend to escalate. Abuse it comes in many forms. You know, there's physical, there's emotional, there's financial, there's sexual, there's psychological. I would even say that there's spiritual. And it gets worse and worse and worse every time you go back to them, okay? So what can you do to prepare yourself for hoovering? Go no contact. Block them ahead of time. Block them right now on Facebook. Block any, if you can, block any friends and any of their family on Facebook. Possibly even take your Facebook account off, or develop one with a fake name for just your immediate friends. You have to go, this is something too that victims have a hard time with. I had a hard time with this. You are probably going to want to treat this relationship like you would any other relationship, where you have, you know, boundaries and you're assertive and you do all these things. You really can't do that with a narcissist, because they are highly manipulative. They're playing to win. They're not into open and honest communication. So you really don't want to do that. You really don't even really want to have open and honest communication with anybody that knows them and likes them. So if you're having possibly friends or family, maybe even your own friends and family, asking you, well, why did you get this fake Facebook account? You know, why are you switching names? Just make up something. So they're not going to understand what kind of relationship you went through if they've never been through something like this. So you could just say, you know what, I just needed a clean slate. Maybe I'll go back to my other account down the road. But I will say too, if people are questioning, why are you doing this? Then don't really befriend them. Like, the whole goal with preparing yourself for hoovering is to put a wall up around you so they can't get to you, okay? So go no contact, block them on Facebook, block their phone number on your phone, set up all their emails to go to your spam folder so you don't have that trauma of seeing that they've emailed you, because that'll really like ruin your day, right? And it can rattle you for days, if not weeks after that. And I will link, there's a video I did on like the more common types of hoovering, but in a nutshell, it's gonna be stuff like, you know, they have cancer, or they're suicidal, or they're an addict, or they're truly sorry, or they found God, or somebody else has cancer, or maybe they're having a heart attack, or they found some of your stuff in one of their boxes when they moved out and they want to get it back to you, or they need to talk to you about bills. There's going to be something that they're using to try to get you to reopen communication. And the victim's probably going to feel like, well, it doesn't hurt to say, to talk to them about the phone bill, right? Or, oh my gosh, so-and-so has cancer, I need to get back to them. Or they're suicidal, what do I do? The reality is you still do not open contact. If they're suicidal, you call 911. If a mutual friend of yours has cancer, you contact that mutual friend. If they have cancer, sucks to be them. Like, you do not open contact with them. It's too much of a risk, because keep in mind, they are out to use you as a source of supply. These people are con artists, emotional con artists for sure, oftentimes financial con artists. So try to think of them that way. I was getting emails from Steve from a fake email address. This will happen most likely to you too as well. I was really mad. I didn't want to have to change my email address. I was so irritated that I had to really alter my life because of him. So hindsight being what it is, I really wish I would have just not used that email address for a while. But you know, I was just being stubborn. I caused myself a lot of unnecessary pain doing that. But what I did do is I created a folder in my email for whenever he would email me, and I labeled it Pet Cemetery. So if you're familiar with that movie, it's a family that has a little boy. He's absolutely adorable. He gets killed. They bury him in this pet cemetery, and then he comes back from the dead. But what comes back, it looks like the little boy, it talks like the little boy, but it's an evil version of the little boy. Narcissists, you think of a narcissistic relationship like that. It's a pet cemetery relationship. Once you see that mask slip, you see that bad behavior, their total lack of empathy, their total lack of regard, their level of lying, their level of deceit, then you realize this person might look like your ex-boyfriend or your ex-husband. They might talk like them. They might dress like them, but they are not them. The person that you loved does not exist and never existed. And what's come back is evil, and it will destroy you if you let them stay in your life. They will suck you dry emotionally and financially. There is no such thing as a healthy relationship with a narcissist. It's impossible. So keep reminding yourself of that. And when you start falling back into that, those feelings of that you miss them, because you will, because the person that you loved was an amazing person. We would have all loved that person, right? But that person wasn't real. That person did not exist. So it's perfectly normal and understandable that you're grieving the loss of that manufactured person. But separate in your mind, that person never existed. That was smoke and mirrors. That was a mask. The reality is you have this highly destructive person now in your life that you've got to get rid of. So keep telling yourself it's real. And that you don't miss him, you miss who he pretended to be. Keep reminding yourself of this. I would even say write it down. I did a series of affirmations. I have a whole bunch of flashcards that I kept by my bed. And I was gonna do another video on this at some point. I had all these different flashcards so I could remind myself every single morning of the mindset that I wanted to cultivate. I'll do another video on this, but I did what I call my little Buddha board. And it was all of these sayings that I needed, this of the mindset that I needed to cultivate in order to stay sane. Because I felt like I was losing my mind. At the time, I didn't know anything about narcissists or sociopaths or any of these people. And so I thought it was just me. And I was paranoid. I couldn't sleep. I was having night terrors. All these things. And that's normal. That's normal after a narcissistic relationship. It's not normal if it doesn't go away really within probably about, 3 to 6 months. So you can always see a doctor. I highly recommend people, if you're having a hard time, get on an antidepressant, get on an anti-anxiety medication. If you're comfortable with taking getting some help. Sometimes we all need help. So, let's see. You know, they're probably going to try to contact you through other people, possibly your children. Realize that they are incredibly charming and that they are probably telling people all kinds of stuff. They're playing the victim if they're trying to get you back. They're letting other people know that they're so in love with you that they'll do anything to make it work. They do a great job of giving lip service. They charm people with their words, right? And a lot of times with their superficial actions until that mask slips and until you see their awful behavior for what it really is. So you might be getting hoovered by other people. That's called a flying monkey, and that's basically where they recruit other people to kind of attack the victim and push the victim into doing what they want. So I've seen this happen with children of all ages, even adult children, where you have maybe, let's say you have a couple, the man is the narcissist and the woman finally wants this divorce, and the guy goes and recruits the children and is like, you know, you don't, I love your mother so much, she won't give us another chance. And the children start pushing the mother, you know, well, give dad another chance, he's really, really sorry, I think this time he means it, you know, how can you walk away? Now all of a sudden the mom is the bad guy for wanting to get out of this craziness. So very well-intentioned good people can be turned into flying monkeys. They can assist in this hoovering process. Be prepared for them to have launched some sort of smear campaign against you. Again, narcissists, you know, they are always the victim or the hero of their own story. So they are probably telling a lot of lies. Lies, the stories that they told you about all of their crazy exes are what you are now, right? So those people are not, probably were not crazy. They were normal people who ended up leaving the relationship or were kicked out of the relationship, and the narcissist is having to do this whole smear campaign against them. So be prepared for the smear campaign. Be prepared for, you know, other people to really not understand what you're going through. It's really helpful to join a support group for this so you can bounce ideas off. You can get kind of clarity as to how to handle the hoovering if it does start up for you. Do not let it suck you back in. It is not real. It is not real. It is not real. It is not real. So you're going to feel really maybe like a cold, calloused, bitchy person for not responding, especially if you're getting texts or emails that somebody has cancer or somebody recently died or something like that. But you've really got to go into self-protection mode, and you've got to think of other ways to communicate with these other people that all of a sudden have all these illnesses other than through the narcissist. And do not let them charm you. They're going to make it seem like you're overreacting or it's no big deal or what's the harm? Like, what's the harm? Like, we can, you know, we can text a little bit back and forth and that's okay. And don't do it. Don't open that door again. Remember, 7 times. It takes victims on average of 7 times. Think about how much time that is, that equates to in your life. How much time you're throwing away by being with these people. They don't ever change. They only get worse with age. They get worse with time. They get worse with therapy. They get worse. The more open and honest you are about issues in your relationship, the worse they get, because the better they get at hiding their behavior. So the only strategy is to get the heck out of there. Go no contact. Ideally, if you can. If you can't go no contact, you can use a technique called gray rock. Gray rock is basically where you become as exciting and as reactive as a gray rock. So when they start telling you things like this, like, I'm suicidal, I'm an alcoholic, I have cancer, that you don't respond, that you're like, wow, I'm really sorry to hear that, right? Like, if you have to have contact, if you have kids with them or you work with them or whatever, that you don't show any emotion because they're trying to provoke you. They're trying to get some sort of reaction out of you. They can only tell what's important to you by how you react, which is crazy, right? But because they're trying every single angle, so they're going to try. Is it the kids? If I tell her that there's something issue with someone with issue with the kids or the parents or the cancer or the this or the that, as soon as you react to one of those, they're going to know that's it. That's the crack I've been looking for. And then they're going to start tapping away on that crack until they're back into your life. So don't give them that. Don't show any reaction. I know it's going to be so hard because you just want to probably throttle these people, but they thrive off of your emotional energy. They really, really do. So that's basically how to prepare for a hoover. Oh, I forgot the biggest one. Make a list. I did this. This is fantastic. Make a list called for when you miss him and write down bullet points of everything that's terrible that he did. So when you miss him, you can look at this paper at a glance and scan it and be like, oh yeah, that's why I can't have him in my life anymore. He cheated. He had children by other women that I didn't know about. He drained the bank account. He's lying to our kids. He's beating the kids. He kicked the dog. He killed the dog. He, you know, stole a car. He's done all this bad behavior. So when you're having these weak moments where you're tempted to open contact, you can read this list and be like, right, okay. And it sobers you up and you're like, that's why I can't be with him anymore. So if you have any questions, comments, concerns, frustrations, ideas for videos, you just want to say hi, you want to share part of your story, let me know. My email is going to be down below, as with my website and my support group, narcissistsupport.com. And I will see you soon. Okay, bye.